Good morning. What a beautiful day to wake up to, wasn't it? It still is, and it's a beautiful day to be together as siblings in Christ, brothers and sisters, worshiping as a community. As many of you know, I'm Patricia Berry. I'm your Minister of Faith Formation. Our interim minister is away until Friday on a little break, and we'll be back next week for our service, which will be outside. I'll tell you about that in a minute. So today's worship, you have me and you have David leading the good news message and helping to create a welcoming space for worship. Whether you're at home on Zoom or watching YouTube later on this week or here in the flesh, we're glad you're here. Whether this is the first time you're joined us or you've been here every Sunday, we're glad you're here. Whether you're a seeker or a doubter or a little bit of both, we're glad you're here. No matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, we're glad you're here and you're welcome here at United Congregational Church. Today is Sunday, August 20th, the 12th day after Pentecost, and we will be exploring the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 15, verses 21 through 28, which highlights the difficult conversation between Jesus, his disciples, and a Canaanite woman, and what it has to do with God's mission for the world today. Be prepared to be stretched. We have a few announcements today. Derek would like me to let you know he's on vacation tomorrow. The office will be closed and available whenever we have volunteers here to open it up, and he'll be back at his desk on Tuesday. And wanted to extend another thank you for everyone who's participated in our summer Vespers Wednesday renewal in the Cedars. It was quite successful. This is our third summer, and we made some changes by offering it every week and upgrading our technology so all could hear what was going on. And it was just a beautiful summer. Every Wednesday, we were able to be outside in that setting sun. And we had speakers every Wednesday to share their reflection on a creation theme. And it was just a blessing to hear people's thoughts and how God speaks to them and their experiences with faith. Next Sunday, we have our second annual Blessing of the Animals, and yes, it will be outdoors. Yeah, at 10 a.m. right here in Theater Chapel. We'll bring some extra chairs out there. We did it last year, and we're tweaking it a little bit, but it was quite successful. And yes, bring your live animals, as long as they're leashed or caged. Photos of your loved furry friend are great, too. Maybe there's a loved one that's passed on, and you would like a prayer over the photo. And stuffed animals, not just for kids, but if you have a favorite animal, a stuffy at home that you'd like to bring, please bring that. It's fun, it's joyful, and it's a way to engage all ages. And as we prepare for next Sunday, I'm looking for two storytellers to share an animal faith story. Last year, we had Donna Netterman speak about being a greyhound rescue family, and Arlene talked about being a beekeeper. So I'd love to have just 5 minutes and just talk about how an animal maybe has touched your lives or why animals are important to you. And I'm looking for a couple blessers to help me bless the animals and stuffies and photos after worship during fellowship time. It's very sweet. And it's a good one to bring your company and your neighbors to. So I invite you to extend that invitation. Before I close with my announcements, I wanted to, some of you may already know the sad news we got wind of yesterday. Our sister in Christ, Libby Ivy, has transitioned. I know, I'll hold back the tears too. Transitioned to our Heavenly One yesterday after battling various health issues and being in and out of hospitals the last 2 years. And Libby was near and dear to many of us, her caring nature, her laughter, her sarcasm, and her wisdom will be missed. She was a blessing to the world. Her daughters let us know that it was a beautiful, peaceful transition yesterday, and they are so grateful for the love that our church has extended to them and all the visits and cards. It's meant a lot. And the family's looking at Thursday, September 28th, to honor and celebrate Libby's life and all all the ways she touched us. So stay tuned. We'll confirm the date and the time as we move through the week. We have another announcement from Christine.
Good morning. It's a little hard to follow, but bear with me.
My name is Christine Fagan. Is it not on? My name is Christine Fagan, and I'm speaking today as a member of the Board of Missions for our church and a member of the Christian Action Center Board, which oversees the community meal program for Aquidneck Island. I am particularly concerned about the need for leadership in our community meal program as Barbara Reese and Mary DeBara step down as community meal leaders after more than 10 years of service. United Congregational Church served our first community meal in April 2006 after waiting 5 years for a slot to open. The churches and social service agencies that engage in the community meal program are very committed to this mission. Barbara and Mary will be coordinating their last community meal this month, and I want to thank them deeply for all they have done over the years. I also want to thank everyone who has participated in this program over the years. Leadership is important to maintaining our continued participation in the community meal program. However, please know that the responsibilities are shared among many, including the cooking. Therefore, I ask those of you who have thought about taking on this responsibility and anyone who thinks it might be right for them to seriously consider serving as a community meal coordinator for our church. If you have questions, please feel free to contact Barbara, Mary, or me. Many thanks for your consideration.
Oh, thank you. Yes, it's hard to make announcements, especially following the announcement about Libby, but I think Libby's spirit is with us and she would be happy to hear that message and that we're still caring for our community. And in the tradition of our church, I'd like to dedicate today's worship for Libby. Let us continue to prepare our hearts and minds for worship with our opening hymn. Let all the people praise the God of all nations. Let us give thanks and enjoy the blessings God gives. The earth has yielded its blessing. Let all the ends of the earth revere our Creator. Let us lift our voices for the prayer of invocation. How good and pleasant it is, O God, when kindred live together in unity. Draw us now into the community you intend for all your people. Help us to listen and understand both your work for us and our sharing with another. Keep us from being misled by popular acclaim and the wisdom of the marketplace. May we not be unobservant guides to one another, but rather be fully open to your gifts and obedient to your call. Come to us now with healing and blessing. Amen.
Morning. Let us join our hearts in prayer. God of many blessings, whose gifts to us are more numerous than we can count, show us how to use these benefits according to your will and purpose, that opportunities may be opened for all your children and unity may become a reality among us. May we know a taste of eternal life in the quality of our mutual caring, our work for justice, and our sharing with a needy world. Speak to us now through the mystery of your holy word. Amen. Our first reading this morning is Psalm 67, found on page 460 in your pew Bible. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine upon us, that your way may be known upon the earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us. May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere him. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from the region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of the Lord.
There I was under the table with my brother and the family dog, Candy, feeling loved. The day was Saturday, Sabbath in my mom's tradition, when she and the aunts and Grammy would gather at the table and pour coffee and break bread, Edamame cheese Danishes, raspberry Danish, and sharing their weekly joys and concerns and how Jesus was in those stories, how they could help a family in need, children that need clothes or diapers. As with every Saturday morning gathering in our rural New Hampshire home, they would hold hands and begin with prayer. An adult hand or two would reach under the table for us, searching for us, widening the circle, the praying circle, to make sure we were among them. It wasn't that we couldn't sit at the table with the adults. We just prefer to be under the table with the dog, listening and playing and lying on Candy and just being part of that family energy, satisfied with whatever crumbs of love would fall from the table. We'd pop our heads up every once in a while for a real morsel, help stir a coffee or two, tug on mom's arm or snuggle up with Grammy. Yes, we'd whine or tattle. Seeking acknowledgement, demanding to be seen. And we'd be sent away to go play every once in a while if we became too pesky, when the conversation became too sensitive for our little ears. Or we would leave on our own, Candy in tow, filled up with the crumbs, satisfied, knowing we were a part of this sacred circle, God's circle. Church was something different for me growing up. We didn't belong to the traditional church until later, when Dan and I started having a family and found our home with a congregational church. But growing up, my family was shooed away, excluded, ostracized by the institutional church over and over again. We didn't fit in. My grandmother, a devout Christian, deeply spiritual woman, and a chartered member of the local Seventh-day Adventist church, was kicked out, excommunicated, not once, but twice, for not following the rules and the practices of the time. Their immorality, church mission, was hard to follow. One of the reasons she was kicked out happened on a Saturday after church. My grandmother was seen escorting my grandfather, who chose to be at the local tavern. Bible in one hand, grandfather in the other. What demonic behavior, their church would say. The second time was for leaving my grandfather, or at least trying to. A heathen possessed by the devil, they shouted in the 1940s. My mother, a deeply spiritual woman also, married an Irish Catholic who now was also damned by the church, especially when she returned to the hills of New Hampshire from the flatlands of Massachusetts, divorced with four little ones to feed. The neighborhood Catholic church also sent her away. Her divorced woman status, single mother for presence, was too loud for the church and too loud for this neighborhood in the 1970s. She was one of the first divorced women in this small rural town. They even had petitions against her for trying to buy a home. Oh, you could hear the shuddering, can't you? The disgrace, the sadness. They couldn't have that kind of person in their churches or around. According to them, her worthiness in the eyes of God was in question. And her children's Massachusetts accents didn't help either. We were seen as foreigners, the unclean, often referred to as those flatlanders. Now, a charity crumb or two would be tossed our way from the table. Hungry, we'd eat it and find our way back in the pew or in the church basement for some kind of event, only to be disappointed again. My brothers and I did attend the CCD classes at St. Peter's during the school year, and I loved the Vacation Bible School with the Seventh-day Adventist Church in the summer. We tried to learn their ways, to follow the rules. We never really felt like we belonged, nor did we understand their definition of the Christian mission. They said one thing and did another. A loving hand did not reach under the table for ours. We were prevented from popping up and helping to stir coffee or speak with conviction. The morsels that were offered to us were often laced with pity or judgment. We did not fit the mold of who they thought was worthy of God's grace. Their missional church circle did not include us. We made them feel uncomfortable. Our presence created tension. We stretched them. Today's gospel reading is an uncomfortable tense dialogue between the disciples, Jesus, and a Canaanite woman that stretches us today. It's an uneasy place in the movement's mission. Who's in and who's out? And equity, justice, prejudice, compassion, conviction, and faith all wrapped up in this one pericope, told orally from 30 to 40 years before it was even recorded in the Gospel of Matthew and Mark. Jesus and his disciples went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon, a Gentile pagan territory, an area known for hostility. Bad blood runs deep in this area between the Jews and the Gentiles. And we have a tenacious Canaanite woman, an unclean woman, a non-Jew appearing on the scene, shouting for mercy, recognizing Jesus for his authority as the Son of David, using psalmist language, urging him to help her daughter who is tormented by the devil. She is kneeling and praying for help, stating she is satisfied with the crumbs that would fall off the master's table, demanding she is worthy of God's love. Send her away. She keeps shouting after us, the disciples said. Jesus, send her away. And Jesus said nothing. How strange. His silence surely makes us pause today. That's not the Jesus we know. And causing more tension and uneasiness for us is when we hear Jesus reply to the woman, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." As if to say to her, helping you was not my understanding of the mission. You're not a lost sheep. You're not one of God's chosen people. We need to take care of our own first. You're not as worthy? Wait, what's going on here? Why is Jesus acting like this? What's happening? Why is this woman like this in this gospel story? The uneasiness continues for us. Did Jesus really just call her a dog? Using this ancient derogatory slang word Jews used for the Gentiles of the time, highlighting the us and them dichotomy of the mission? She's not deterred. Her presence is bold and loud and relentless. Unlike other portrayals of women of the time, she has agency and power and represents the voices from the margin, demanding to be seen, embodying an unexpected level of faith, a level of faith that some of Jesus' disciples have not even exhibited yet. Then there's a shift. Woman, Jesus now calls her, using a biblical term of endearment, marking a family relation. Your faith is great. And he heals her daughter. Boom, done. Just like that. It is here, through the tension and uncomfortableness, we witness God breaking through, broadening the understanding of the Holy One's mission. Or as Letty Russell put it in her book, Church in the Round, here in this moment, Jesus is broadening his ministry of hospitality to those outside of the house of Israel, opening the circle of God's household to others, to foreigners, to those who did not identify as Jewish, to the disenfranchised, to the unclean. Scholarship differs whether Jesus knew what was going to happen or not. He was the one to bring them to this unclean territory in the first place. Regardless, God is teaching us something powerful here. Gospel writers must have included this painful, harsh story for a reason. For a reason today. Following Jesus has the power to stop us in our tracks indeed. Stretch our cultural understandings, liberate, empower, elevate voices from the margin, and challenge our preconceived notions of faith, family, and mission. This gospel reading shows us that entering uncomfortable dialogues, places of tension, challenging spaces, oh, that's when we hear God breaking through with the kingdom of heaven, as if to say, lean in and pay attention. I have something to say. Churches have changed over the years, evolved with the times, the Seventh-day Adventists and the Catholic Church traditions and many other denominations, including Congregationalists, have let go of their harsh practices and barriers of the past. But we still see evidence of harmful practices, hate and violence and prejudices, exclusion across the modern day spectrum of Christianity. We just need to turn on the news. The church mission was and still can be too focused on its own needs, own definition of salvation, cleanliness, who's worthy of God's grace, who's in and who's out. Churches have a hard time looking beyond themselves, looking in the mirror to see that it's about God's needs and mission in the world and not theirs. Today, our definition of church mission is being challenged. Our patterns of existence, our understanding of church, the power structure, systems, our Christian identity, are constantly under fire. And many of us want to turn from those uncomfortable places and the tension and cling to what we know. Turn down the dial of the Canaanite woman of today. The noises from the margins are overwhelming and can be deafening, whether it's shouts about global warming, racial justice, addiction, mental health, the LGBTQ community, school shootings, suicides, homelessness, and the hungry, you name it. These voices from the margins are calling us to those uncomfortable spaces and places, demanding to be recognized, acknowledged, and valued. And if we're honest, we sometimes respond like the early disciples. Jesus, send them away. They keep shouting at us to do something. We're not sure what to do, what that something is. What does this have to do with our church mission today? And much like the disciples, we turn to Jesus and watch and wait to see what he does next. Yes, we throw a few loving crumbs. We may even join the voices shouting, eat some of the crumbs ourselves, start a program or project through our church buildings, or hang a flag. But as Alex Ruxburg and Scott Warren wrote in their Introducing the Missional Church, what is, why it matters, and how to become one, if not about programs and projects. It's about how a church embodies God's story today, embodies God's church's mission for the world. It's about going into foreign territory, being a part of uncomfortable conversations and places and spaces, listening and connecting and engaging and building relationships to help us let go of any of our hidden prejudices, open our limited human views, to keep growing spiritually and closer to God and become more aware and expand our understanding of God's kingdom of heaven that's in our midst. Friend, God is breaking through all the time, especially today, bringing forth the voices from the margins to help us move us and invite us to witness and proclaim and act, widening the circle so we can provide loving spaces to reach over and across and under the tables for hands that need connection, that are worthy of God's love. Let's continue as a church to make sure we're answering God's call to widen God's circle, sacred circle, to help break barriers of oppression, to be allies to the lost and the suffering and the lonely, to embody the good news with our whole beings, with our actions, our words, and our presence. Let us continue to be courageously faithful to our Lord and follow Jesus' lead. For God's church's mission for the world is greater than our imagination, greater than our own. May all of creation be transformed by God's mission, and may we take an active role in loving all of God's creation. Amen. Let us go to God in prayer. Lord, we praise you. Your face shines upon us in the morning light, in the reflection in the waves and in the song of the wren, in the moonlit skies. Your glory sings in our hearts through all the days. We are blessed with your glory. We praise you, O God. Your light gives us in the darkness and in the shadows of the night, when worry and tension fills the air. Your saving power reaches us, reaches all nations upon the earth. We are blessed to always be within your reach, held by your love. O God, let all the people praise you. You lead us to and through foreign places so that we may learn how to love you and be like you and be gracious as you. Be patient with us, Lord. Sometimes these spaces are hard and stretch us too much. Provide us with the grace needed. Help us to trust and follow your ways. And remember, you know, and help us to remember, you know what is best. Lord, you are always creating, always breaking through, always inviting us to participate in your new creation. Assure us when we are on the right path. Give us a sign which way to go when we're at the crossroads of change, so we may know this is your way, the way of the Lord. Your love knows no boundaries. We kneel and pray for your mercy, and you bless us all regardless. Most Holy One, we lift up prayers for forgiveness, for closing doors instead of opening them, for not showing compassion when we're tired, not showing compassion when it was needed, for only thinking of ourselves. We lift up prayers for our enemies who turn to hate and violence, who use power and privilege to control, who allow fear to dictate lives. May all the hearts feel the warmth of your presence. This morning, we asked you to be with those who are struggling with health issues and court hearings and addiction, family turmoil and doctor's appointments and insurance claims, those who need a sense of belonging, a place to call home, a plate of food to sustain them, who are struggling with fires and floods. Send your love to our college students and their parents who are leaving for school this week, for our athletes, and for all those teachers and administrators starting to prepare for school. Lord, we have specific names we want to bring to you in this hour, in this time of need, needing your love for this week and the weeks to come. We ask you to wrap your love around Libby Ivy's family and for all of us who she touched with her life. We ask you to be with Aunt Kathy's family, Dave, Nona, Pat, Joe, and Deborah, Fallon, Megan, Young Jai, Dawn, Jeremy, Carol, Cora, Declan, Lynn, Nancy, Tom, Bob, Ginny, Gigi, Barnett, Maggie, Becky, Florence, Shirley, Celeste, Barbara, Nancy, Ellen, Anne, Mary, Bob, Joe, Barbara, Ron, Carol, Matt, Pat, David, those who seek peace, and those who are living in Hawaii, gathering up from the fires of Maui. Lord, we lift many prayers aloud. May we take this sacred moment to pause and be with you silently. We lift all these prayers to you, spoken and unspoken in your name. Let our collective voices pray the prayer Jesus taught us so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Amen. We gather an offering not so much to support an institution as to follow our passions, to share the good news of the realm of God with one another and with many who have never heard of it. Amid an atmosphere of deceit and distrust in the world, where community is seldom realized in our day, we aspire to discover and live God's will for us. Let us give generously. Let the morning offering begin. Lift our voices for the offertory prayer. As you have blessed us, O God, we are eager to share. We want our offerings to preserve and extend life to your children here in this place, wherever our influence and reach. What is in the offering plate is only a part of what we dedicate ourselves to do and be. In your reign of unity, peace may come. Amen. Let us continue with our collective voices for the prayer of the nation. A place to rest, a place to find solace, a place to rejuvenate. God, peace of nature. God, thank you for this great wide country that affords so many places to find what our soul is hungry for. Grant us in the heart of these summer days time to find such a place, even if it's in our own backyard. Let us fetch our breath, touch base with you, and revel in the pleasure of relaxation in the land of Again, it was a joy to be with you and bring the good news message today on August 20th. A reminder, next week we'll be in Cedar Chapel. And now I know if it rains, we will send something out to let you know and just ask you to leave your live animals at home or outside with the window down. And we'll gather and do some blessings in here. We have lemonade and some little snacks out in the narthex. So I invite you to stay and break bread and fellowship with your friends before you head out. And now for the benediction. Go forth filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with joy and peace in your hearts. May the God of hope fuel you with courage to be the light and love in the world. In the name of Jesus, we serve and pray. Amen. Oh,